My thanks. As you hear, my name is Wolf. As you heard, my name is Wolf. I am the co-chair of the Cost Action and also I'm the vice chair for the Erasmus Plus strategic partnership. So I'm partly responsible that you are all here. And I have to talk about a little bit about interstellar chemistry. And for the first time, if you look at it, the interstellar environment, it seems to be a fairly hostile environment for molecules. Most elements are in the atomic form. You have got very low temperatures, which is not really usually very good for chemistry. You have got very low pressures. Reactive collisions are quite infrequent. So the mean free path length is in the interstellar medium about 100,000 kilometers. And you can compare that with about 58 nanometers in our air. So it's not really very exciting. Then you have the UV radiation from the stars. And as you know all, UV radiation destroys molecules. But they can be shielded in dark clouds. And nevertheless, a lot of molecules have been detected in the interstellar medium. And this came a little bit as a surprise, because the famous British astronomer Arthur Eddington, he thought the whole idea about interstellar chemistry is complete rubbish. And some bigwigs in the European Union probably are thinking along this line still. Anyway, in the dark clouds, the UV radiation from the stars can be shielded. And dark clouds are among the coldest environments in the whole space, especially the Bok globally, which are small dark clouds and which are actually in thermal equilibrium with the background radiation. So they can actually be down to 3-4 Kelvin cold. The main questions we astrochemists ask ourselves is, first of all, which molecules do we find in the interstellar medium? And then, of course, in which environments are they produced? Which pathways are they produced with? And then for me, as an experimental chemist, the big question, can we reproduce these processes in the lab? And then, of course, the astronomers are coming in, and we have to check if we can test if these processes are really feasible by astronomic observations. And I will take you along this course. So these are detected interstellar molecules. Unfortunately, the list is very small because we have so many molecules, but you can see a couple of things. Radicals are quite abundant. Radicals are molecules with unpaired electrons and are very reactive. Small molecules are predominant. But this does not really mean that we have only small molecules in the interstellar medium. But these are most of the molecules where we have spectroscopic data for the detection in the interstellar medium. And we are behaving a little bit like the Norwegian who lost his key on his way home from the pub and only searched under the streetlight, because if it would be somewhere else, he would not find it. So we have to have good spectroscopic data to find these molecules, and the spectroscopic data you mostly have from the smaller molecules and not from the larger. For an astrobiologist, of course, it's not so bad that in these molecules hydrogen, carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, and sulfur dominate. The metals that what we as chemists call metals, they are somewhat rare. So the abundance of elements in the interstellar medium looks like that. This is the astronomer's periodic table. So the most failing is the hydrogen, which is not too bad because, I mean, you need the hydrogen. CNO for the astrobiologists. But unfortunately, with the trace elements here, which are very important for life, it doesn't really look too good. So the interstellar medium, interstellar chemistry, is probably dominated by HCNO. And the rest is a little bit just curiosity. You have seen this already. This is actually the different factories of interstellar molecules. You have heard in the first lecture that dying stars can form planetary nebula and white dwarf. And these planetary nebula, they send off a lot of substance into the interstellar medium. The same applies for supernova. When they explode, they send a lot of supernova remnants out into the space, and these remnants can form again molecular clouds, which then can form protostars and then evolve into so-called main sequence stars. And when they die, they can go through this sequence again. So molecular clouds are important because not only they function as stellar nurseries, they also do a lot of chemistry. We usually distinguish in astrochemistry between dark clouds and diffuse clouds. And not very surprising, the dark clouds shield the light from the stars from behind. But if you look at the dark cloud in the infrared, then you can see the stars behind because the infrared is less scattered by the grains that make up the dark cloud. So with the infrared, you can see that Herschel was actually wrong when he first believed that dark clouds are holes in the sky. So in the IR, you can actually see the background stars. On the other hand, you have got the diffuse clouds, where the light from stars at the back are visible. And sometimes they are so thin that you actually cannot really see them with the naked eye. Here, we are lucky that we have some reflection from stars inside these diffuse clouds or beside these diffuse clouds in the so-called Rosette Nebula, where you can actually see the material. The existence of dark clouds has been known very long. The Australian Aborigines on the southern hemisphere, you can see actually these dark cloud series in the Milky Way, and they called it an emu in the sky. The Australian outback is a good place to observe stars because it's very dry. Usually the weather is fine and you have very little light pollution. Dark and diffuse clouds are two classes, but usually also you distinguish in the diffuse clouds between atomic and molecular clouds. Where the atomic clouds, they are very thin, they contain hydrogen in the form of atoms. The diffuse molecular clouds, they are a little bit thicker, and between the diffuse and the translucent clouds, in the diffuse and the dense clouds, you have the so-called translucent clouds. In the diffuse atomic clouds, all molecules are quickly destroyed. Hydrogen is an atomic form, so they are very boring for us chemists. Diffuse molecular clouds are also surrounded by atomic gas, so they are not really, let's say, homogeneous. Whereas in the darker clouds, you have got more molecules, and even in the translucent clouds, you start to store carbon, mostly in the form of carbon monoxide. And this is important because carbon monoxide can be quite a nice source for interstellar molecules. I will come back to that. Diffuse clouds, you mostly observe against bright background stars, like Zeta Ophi, Zeta Persei, and you only more or less have absorption observations because the emission lines are usually too weak. The molecules are not so easy to gauge because the abundance is not so good, but they can also also contain quite a lot of chemistry. Usually they are onion-shaped, and the dense parts in the middle of the cloud can actually contain quite a lot of different molecules. Dark clouds are a little bit more interesting for us because they are chemically more rich. Dark clouds can have about 5 × 10⁵ solar masses, so they are quite massive, and the temperature usually ranges between 10 and 50 Kelvin. They can have quite a large extension. Radius can be about 100 parsec. You know now what the parsec is about. I have not really have to repeat that. And the particle density can be up to about 10 to 6 per centimeters. Now, this is still in the range of the best vacuum we can achieve on Earth. But there still is molecular processes going on. These dark clouds are actually quite dramatic. Their formation goes very fast. So 4 million years on astronomical timescale, this is nothing. And as you can see, like in this Horsehead Nebula, which is in the Orion constellation, which is a little bit the textbook example for a hard, for a dark cloud, you have got quite irregular edges. This looks a little bit like the coast of Norway. And you have got already, as already mentioned, filamentary structures. So these dark clouds are not at all homogeneous. There can be star-forming regions. There are some denser regions here, so-called dense cores. There are also outflows from emerging stars, which lead to ionizations, the so-called H2 regions. There are protoplanetary disks. So in many dark clouds, you have got a lot of different features and processes going on. So they are not at all homogeneous. They're not all at all black, dusty clouds. And they can also form clumps. And in these clumps, the gravity causes a further collapse. And this chemistry leads to more complicated species. And since the dark clouds contain grains, the dark clouds are cold, so these species can freeze out on the grains. But the collapse is not unhindered. There are counterbalancing effects. First of all, you have the rotation of the cloud. Then you have got a certain gas pressure. When you work with ions, you have also to take care of the magnetic pressure, because the ions will actually tend to follow the magnetic lines. And you have got magnetohydrodynamic turbulences. So the collapse of a dark cloud is, or a clump in a dark cloud, is not completely unhindered. But when it happens, from a dark cloud, you can get a gas clump, which can break off from the molecular cloud and start to collapse. You form a so-called dense core, which rotates, because you always have some rotation on. And as has been said already, after the theories of Kant and Laplace, the gravitation pulls towards the center, and the rotation, the centrifugal velocity, pulls material out to the edges. So what you get mostly is a protostar, which can already emit in the infrared, and a disk here, which can then evolve into a protoplanetary disk and into a planetary system. When this infrared is stopped and the star starts the nucleosynthesis, it blows off the rest of the clouds and you get a planetary system. And chemistry plays a role in all of these stages. First, the formation of a clump, formation of a dense core with a small protostar, then formation slowly of a protoplanetary disk, which evolves into here, and finally a planetary system. Molecules can form in these dark cores. They can be cooled by emission of radiation. They freeze out on the grains. And during the evaporation, during the star formation, these molecules can desorb again from the grains. And you get a very rich chemistry. And some volatile compounds created in the dark clouds might even be delivered to planets by comets. So it is not completely excluded that some of the organic molecules are ending then up on planetary surfaces. This is a picture of such a star-forming region. Again, in the visible light, it looks like boring. This is the nebula, so it's nothing really special. If you look in the infrared, you see already the emerging star here. And you can observe the collapse by Doppler effect, because through to the higher velocity, you get either an increase or a decrease of the wavelength of emitted lines due to the effect, due to the Doppler effect caused by the motion of the molecules into the center of the cloud. And that you can actually observe leads to a broadening of the lines. And when the collapse has proceeded, then if there is a certain mass achieved, then you can form a hot core. hot core is a young star inside an envelope of gas, and it can heat its envelope by radiation from the star, but also by the shocks caused by the infall of the material to up to 100 Kelvin. And as I said already, a lot of chem molecules can evaporate, and you can get a very rich chemistry in the gas phase. This is an artist's conception of a massive protostar. You can see the outflows, which are eggshell, and then you can see this aggregation disk, which might then actually evolve into a protoplanetary disk and in a planetary system. The chemistry of outflows is also interesting, because when these outflows from the star hits the ambient medium, which often is a dark cloud, you create a shock zone. And in this shock zone, you can even get temperatures up to 2,000 to 3,000 Kelvin. And this, of course, makes chemical processes possible, which are not possible at low temperatures. There are different kinds of shocks. There are continuous shocks, which are a little bit colder, where the shock is not really that dramatic, but there's also so-called jump shocks, which can lead to very, very high temperatures. And unfortunately for us chemists, these jump shocks tend to destroy all molecules. They create a lot of UV radiation, but in the wake of the shocks, when it's cooler again, these molecules can reform. So, for us astrobiologists, of course, is a question how we get from here to here. For astrochemists, you have the question how we get from here to here. How we get from the astronomer's periodic table to all the molecules which are. Now, in the dark clouds, I've already told you, the dominating species is hydrogen in the molecular form. It is shielded from the UV light, but you can still have the cosmic radiation, which can create ions. And that leads to chemistry, and that can even get up to molecules with large carbon chains. The molecules can be destroyed by reactions with radicals. They are very reactive because they have unpaired electrons by definition. Ionization by cosmic radiation is an important process, and ion neutral reactions are also important. But just why these processes? Just why don't really we have this nice terrestrial chemistry between neutral molecules? The answer is there are some requirements for chemical reactions in the interstellar medium to happen. First of all, you are restricted to reactions which deliver energy, so-called exothermic reactions. Secondly, most reactions, they have a barrier, which you have first to surmount to start the reaction. And that is not possible at very low temperatures. Now I've got low pressures, so you can't have any processes that involve free more or more molecules, which you already get quite a lot in atmospheric chemistry. And also, you cannot really simply put two species together and get a single product, because somehow you have to dispose of the angular momentum, and somehow you have to dispose of the energy. But we have got some other bodies which can take up the job. And that are the interstellar grains, because they can act as third bodies and take the momentum of the reactions. And they can also take up energy very easily, because seen from a molecule's dimension, these interstellar grains are quite large. So a lot of processes which are not possible in the gas phase can work on grains. So, for the chemists, this is a little bit redundant, but I would like to just remind you how you do calculate the energy or the so-called enthalpy of the reactions. Why do you work with enthalpies? Because enthalpies are defined, chemical enthalpies are defined at constant pressure, constant temperature. And usually that is what you want to work in chemistry. So what you have to do to calculate the reaction enthalpy of the reaction, you take the enthalpy of the product of a reaction, for example, the formation of water, which you look up in some tables, and then you take the subtract the energy of the reactants, which in the case of an element in its most stable form is defined as zero. And then you calculate the formation of water to water molecules at -484 kilojoule per mole. Minus means that the reaction would deliver energy, can proceed voluntarily. If this is positive, then the reaction will consume energy and will not be very feasible in the interstellar medium. The question is thermodynamics everything? And since thermodynamics usually is quite a hate subject for students, I am happy to tell you that it is of course not. Because as I said, mostly from the reactants going to the products, you cannot go directly. You have to surmount a certain energy barrier. Most reactions do require the energy, the activation energy. So even if you light some petrol or you light some gas, you have to first light the burner, you have to first invest energy to start the reaction, which then can actually deliver more energy than you have invested, but the investment is there. Most reactions do require activation energies, but there are some who don't. For those who require energy, I have to quote a Swedish researcher, Svante Arrhenius, who studied this, and he found out that the reaction rate, which is a measure for the velocity of the reaction, is dependent on the temperature in an inverted exponent, negative exponential way. So K, a measure for the reaction velocity, is dependent on a constant times on the height of this activation energy divided by constant divided by the temperature. And you see very easy, when you do a logarithmic, single logarithmic plot, a so-called Arrhenius plot, this against 1 divided by t, k against 1 divided by t, will lead a straight line, which is negative. So that means that reactions which require an activation energy not surprisingly work better at higher temperatures. So what is then the case when you have no barrier? Well, a little bit of astronomy helps here. Because if you want to find out if a meteor which is bypassing the Earth and has a certain velocity will hit the surface or not, it depends of course on the velocity, but it depends also on the distance between the axis between the axis parallel to the velocity and the distance here, and of course on the gravity field. So if the gravity field is large, or the velocity or this distance is low, it will be likely that the meteorite hits the Earth. And for each velocity and for each gravitational field, which is of course constant if you have the same body, there is a certain maximum distance between this axis and the velocity vector where the meteorite just hits the surface. So when you go then to 3 dimensions, then this distance becomes a circle with a certain radius, and it is circle R max square P is called the cross section. And it depends on the velocity, of course, The slower this is, the more likely it will be hit. And of course, on the attractive force. Chemistry, in with a chemical reaction, it's quite similar. So also here, you have got an attractive force, which is the chemical potential here. And also here, you have got the velocity, which is dependent on the temperature in the ambient. And also here, you have got the cross section, which defines the maximum distance this reactant partner can pass by and still is able to react with the other molecules. And interestingly, this cross section decreases when the molecules get faster. Not so surprising. So, in the case of a reaction with a barrier, we have got the so-called Arrhenius behavior, and you see that the reaction velocity will diminish with lower temperatures or increase with higher temperatures. In the case of a barrierless process, you have a so-called Langevin behavior. So that means that K is dependent on a constant times T to the minus A. So that means it works better at lower temperatures. And that is good for us astrochemists. In tables, you usually use the so-called Cauchy formula, which is a combination of these both. You have got three constants, alpha, beta, and gamma. With beta is zero, you have got an Arrhenius behavior. It's like that. And with gamma is zero, you have got the Langevin behavior. With alpha zero, you have got no reaction at all. Boring. There are some underlying assumptions. The underlying assumption is that the reaction cross-section is only dependent on the velocity. This sometimes does not hold. It also means that you have got the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution of velocities. This is fine when you have a local thermal equilibrium. In space, you don't always have that. And there are no additional reaction channels opening at high velocities. In case this actually happens, that you get additional reaction channels, you can still mostly use this Cauchy formula. So, the important reactions in the interstellar medium which fulfill that they are barrierless, are neutral-neutral reactions which involve radicals. Why? Because the neutral-neutral reactions, like the reactions with methane and oxygen to form water and CO2, these usually are not feasible at low temperatures. Radical-neutral and radical-radical-neutrons often don't have barriers, are feasible. Also, that applies for ion-electron, ion-ion, and ion-neutral reactions. Mostly also these do not crave any activation energy. So when you look at neutral-neutral reactions versus ion-neutral reactions, in the neutral-neutral reactions, you have mostly you form first a cluster between the reactants, then you form a transition complex, which is higher in energy. Then you form a cluster between the products, and these can dissociate. So here in this case, you have got an energy which is higher than the reactants, and it won't work. Here you have the same picture, also with a transition state, but the transition state is energetically below the reactants, and you have got enough energy to go over here. So ion-neutral reactions and radical-neutral reactions often are feasible. They might have some transition states, but the transition states can be lower than the energy you have at the disposal already, which you're going in with. From the ion process, there are three. Ion-neutral, for example, this one leading to CH+, which is a curiosity because this was the first interstellar molecule which was detected in 1937. So it's a little bit interesting. Ion-electron reactions, mostly that means dissociative recombination. What is that? You combine an ion with an electron, and the energy which is gained by the system by this recombination is used to dissociate the intermediate neutral and form two or even mostly more products. Ion-ion reactions are also possible. You react a cation with an anion and you form two neutrals. There are several processes you can do. So if an ion reacts with H2 in a dark cloud, that is usually what it does, because most dark clouds almost exclusively consist of H2. So H2 is about a factor of 10,000 more abundant than any other chemically interesting species. When an ion doesn't react with H2, it can react with electrons, because also these reactions with electrons, they are quite fast. And then, if those two things are not possible, it can react with another neutral. So if there are fewer electrons, or if the reaction with a neutral is very fast. So you can have a rich chemistry, but first of all, we have ions to begin with. How are they formed? You also have the possibility of radical neutral processes. So you could say, well, why don't we just start with an atom and with H2? Then we can start something like that. The problem is, atomic hydrogen only reacts with fluorine and maybe to some extent with chlorine, but not with other more interesting species. Whereas, for example, atomic nitrogen can react with other species. So if once you can form some hydrogen compounds, you can do some additional further reactions. So the bottom line is that we have to create some molecules which are not H2, because we start before we start some chemistry. So how does that start? I can remind you that I mentioned the cosmic radiation, which was discovered by Victor Franz Hess, Austrian Nobel laureate, and this leads to ionization of molecular hydrogen, leading to H2+. The cosmic ionization rate is about 10 to minus 17 per second in dark clouds. It is different dependent on the different environment, so you don't really have the same cosmic ionization rate in the same in the different environments. And these cosmic rays, they can form H2+. And H2+ reacts very rapidly in the time scale of months to form H3+. And these cosmic rays, as most of you will probably know, consist mostly of protons, other particles, the rest is gamma rays, electrons, muons. So you can then form with this sequence H3+. And with that, you can actually work on. So you can add this H3+ to another atom, which I call X, and add more and more by hydrogens by consecutive reactions with H2. And finally, you form the final ion with an electron. You form a neutral molecule by this was I called dissociative recombination. You add an ion and an electron, and you form two neutrals. And the most important thing we want to form is, of course, water. So we try to do that with water. So we add H3 plus oxygen to form OH plus. There is also another less important process which is emerging from H2. And we play this game on, as I have shown in the previous slide, OH plus H2, leading to H2O plus, and then further on to H3O plus. Now we still have H3O plus and not H2O. So we add an electron and do dissociative recombination. And lo and behold, in 25% of the dissociative recombination event, you get what you want, H2O. There are also some other processes which can lead to H2O in the gas phase, but they're less important. But still, this is not perfect. You get some other products also, which might react on, as you can see. So now you can say, okay, this is very fine. But if you really work with OH plus and H2O plus, you should see them in space. So now here comes a little bit of a tricky bit, as one of your colleagues has already shown the day before yesterday. To observe H2O or H2O plus ions or OH plus from Earth is a very tricky thing, because you have got a lot of water in the ionosphere and in the atmosphere. And to subtract this water is really not easy. And there are leading scientists who got actually this wrong, especially when it comes to observing water at exoplanets. So what you can do is, of course, you can go to space with the Herschel Space Telescope. And with this Herschel Space Telescope, the OH plus lines and the H2O plus lines have actually been observed. So this is a possibility. But also, you can do the same thing on grain surfaces. And on grain surfaces, you can actually put two atoms together and form a molecule, because the grain can take the momentum. The grain can take the energy of these reactions. So it can form H2O plus. H2O, sorry. And that can then be photodesorbed and get into the gas phase. So now we have got a problem, because we can have two mechanisms which can produce water. But we are producing too much. We're getting too much water. And this is dangerous. Because as we know, excess of water leads to drowning. And we drown in our water, which we produce in our models, especially in cold clouds. What could be the solution to that? The first of all would, of course, be that the models are wrong. But there is also another possibility. It might be that we don't see all the water in our observations. Because, as I told you, the dark clouds, they are not homogeneous. So when you go further in the cloud gets colder, denser, and darker. So the opacity, which is shown here, gets more and more. So when you go into the cloud on the cloud edges, you have got a lot of UV irradiation coming in. And that destroys the water. So you have to reach a certain opacity until you get a steady state abundance of water. Whereas in the center of the cloud, where it's really cold and dark, the water freezes out. So just in the intermediate layer, you have got the water, because you have got not yet freeze out, but you are dark enough to be shielded from the photodissociation. So that could be a solution for that. And the water is not just hanging around. It actually freezes out on grains and also do other things that are present in dark clouds. So when you have got a silicate grain here, then when it gets colder and colder, you are going into the cloud, then you freeze out water first and methanol. You create a layer of polar substances. And then you further on absorb carbon monoxide and other less polar substances. This is not that simple because it's going in a continuous way, but it's a good approximation. So when you form the dark clouds and the dark cores collapse and get colder and denser, you form a certain onion-shaped ice layer around the silicate grains. And when then you reach star formation, through the heating and through the UV irradiation from the young star, you can, in these and on these grains, create a huge and very versatile chemistry where you can form things like methanol, polyaromatic hydrocarbons, and other interesting species. So, when you look at the different temperature zones in such a star forming regions, when you're close to the star, you have got a naked grain. When you are less close to the star, you have got a lot of chemistry going on, whereas when you're going out, you have got still the grains with the two layers, the polar layer and the apolar layer. And the further the infall proceeds, you get more and more along these lines. First, the apolar layer evaporates, then you get a lot of chemistry, and finally, you evaporate everything off, and you get the naked grain. So during the life cycle of a star, we have got also a life cycle of these grains, where you have got first this ice layer, which then can be chemically processed by UV light and heat, and then you have got an organic residue layer around the core, which then slowly evaporates, and then you get the naked grain, as I said. Also on the top of surfaces, there can be quite a lot of things happening. So you can have molecules residing on the surfaces, which then can do some reactions. There are different mechanisms. There are three important mechanisms. I apologize for the slow loading of this slide. And the first one is the Ilia-Riedel mechanism, where you actually hit a species absorbed on a grain by another species, and they react and form a product. There's the so-called hot atom mechanism, where actually you hit with a molecule and that, or an atom, and that atom can then hop on the surface until it needs a reaction partner. A little bit a similar mechanism is the Langmuir-Hangelwood mechanism, where you have got two species sticking to the grain, one species slowly moving until it hits a reaction partner and then can form a molecule. The disadvantage of this mechanism is that the reactants have to be mobile. Hydrogen atoms usually are, other species can be less mobile. So at low temperatures, only the hydrogen is mobile. So it can form, for example, water, methane, ammonia, and methanol. At higher temperatures, also other species get mobile. For example, you can form interesting things like dimethyl ether or other molecules, and you can even have polymerization. So CH2O from aldehyde has been shown to polymerize on these grains. And for an astrobiologist, this is of course interesting, because in principle, from the sum formula seen, carbohydrates are polymerates of formaldehyde. Also inside the ices, a lot of things are happening. Photodissociation can then lead to destruction of water, for example, and formation of species which can then react on, for example, in the formation of carbon dioxide. So the energy from the UV photons enables reactions not possible otherwise. And that's why star forming regions are very interesting for us astrochemists. And especially important are the reactions with water or involving water. In a dark cloud, oxygen is mostly the form of oxygen in the atomic and molecular form. So the abundance of water is usually low there. But in star-forming regions, suddenly these processes get possible. So up to 25% of all oxygen in these star-forming regions can be locked in the form of water. There can be also solid O2, but this is very difficult to observe. So it's not easy to determine if that is the case. We have done a certain formation of water involving first H3+ and reacting first the H3+ with an atom and then reacting this molecule further on with H2. So why couldn't this work for carbon also? We could do the same game. First form CH+, and then react CH+ with hydrogen, going on and on and on, and then end up with something which can then, with an electron, form a hydrocarbon. Unfortunately, this here does not work because CH3+ is fairly stable. So another way out is to let the CH3+ react with H2 with a so-called radiative association. These are usually very slow processes, but you can disperse the energy in the form of light. Finally, you have CH5+, and you could think, well, you can form, by reaction with electrons, you can form CH4. Unfortunately, only 5%. So there is no efficient methane formation in the gas phase. So one thing we always have in astrochemistry to decide, can a molecule form in the gas phase, or do we have to resort to surface processes? Why does methane matter? Because coming from methane, you can form by insertion of carbon or and subsequent insertion of carbon in products form long hydrocarbon chains, which then can slowly but surely react to other astrobiologically interesting species. But the question remains, can a substance be formed on the surface, or can it be formed on the gas phase, or on both? Can we test this in the lab? Yes, we can. And as an example, I will give you the methanol. Methanol is very interesting for astronomers because it's responsible for the maser emission in star-forming regions. These masers are characteristic for star-forming regions, and they can help you to distinguish between regions in dark clouds, which are just hotter, and genuine star-forming regions, because only the genuine star-forming regions display this maser. Methanol and the methanol abundance also works as an evolution indicator in star-forming regions. You can use methanol observation to determine the temperature and the density of a certain region simultaneously. That's why methanol has been called the Swiss Army knife of observations. And in comets, you can actually determine the ratio of CH3OH+, protonated methanol and normal methanol, and from there you can get the electron temperature in cometary coma. In the gas phase, the following mechanism has been invoked. CH3+ plus H2O leading to protonated methanol in a radiative association, a photon coming out of here, and by dissociative recombination, then you can form methanol plus H. When this works fine here, then this one, the radiative association, should have a certain velocity. The question is, how can we determine the rates and products of these processes in the lab? For ion reactions, so-called ion traps have been used. AeronTrap is a simple device, but still, its inventor, Paul, has got the Nobel Prize for it. So, what you do actually, you employ, for example, a quadrupole. And, of course, an ion, if it's positive, and this is negative here, and this is positive, it would actually try to move out here. And then you rotate the field in a radio frequency so that it switches and kicks the ion back in again. And this works best when you move to multipole traps, because there you have got a very flat field inside. And in these ion traps, you can trap the ions, you can react them. So this is the field. So you see in the 22 trap, you have got this very flat field, which you want. So this is how such ion traps look like. It's quite a simple device. It's as big as a matchbox about. So what you do is you go in with your ion, you mass select them with an ion deflector, go in, trap the ions in the ion traps, add a cooling gas, mostly helium, and then you add the neutral and you follow the reaction. Because you can, at different times after the reaction started, open this trap and distinguish the products in mass spectrometry. And when you look at the reaction, you have got two processes. You have got this helium buffer gas, so it can do a ternary reaction. But when you plot the helium pressure against the velocity, you get a certain cutoff here. And that is actually the rate of this binary reaction you want. And this rate, unfortunately, is a factor of 60 too low. So the first process doesn't really work very nicely. Let's look at the second one. And the second one, an electron reacting with an ion, you can do that with magnetic storage rings, where you don't trap the ions, you let them circulate in a ring, and the bending of the ion beam is performed by strong magnets. So you form the ions in an ion source, you accelerate them into a ring, you accelerate them further on, and in a device called an electron cooler, you merge the ion beam with an electron beam, and the products, which are neutral, they are not affected by these magnets, they're going out and can be detected. Why do you have to do such large accelerations? Because we want to have very low relative velocities. And the electron is Speedy Gonzales, so with a very small field, you can accelerate it quite highly. And the ions, they are heavy, they are lazy, so we have really to accelerate them very far that we can merge an electron and ion beam with the same velocity. And that's where the fun happens, in the electron cooler. This is the Cryo-Ring device in Stockholm. So you actually go in here with the ion beam into the electron cooler. You produce the electrons from a cathode. These are bent in, and here the reaction happens where the beams overlap. Then you bend the electrons out again, collect them by an anode, and the neutrals, they are going out and can then be detected. But what you see here, then when you do that, is not what you want. Again, the product, what you want, we also did the deuterium, deuterated methanol, because we can get a better mass spectrum there, but you only get 3% of output. So you don't really get the products you want. Most of the dissociative recombination can lead to a lot of fragmentation because they are very exergic, very energy delivering processes. So that's all fine. But what happens when we put it into a model? And the textbook example for a model is the dark cloud TMC1. Why? Because it's a quiescent cloud. It does not do star forming. We want to have something simple. We don't really want to have very complicated things. In the model, you start with H2 and the other elements in the atomic form, which is reasonable. Less reasonable is that you assume a homogeneous spherical cloud, because that's not, as we have seen, that black dark clouds look like. So you put in 4,500 reactions, 450 species, and you get the differential equation system. And you let the model assume an evolving time of the cloud of 5 million years. That's about the lifetime of a cloud. At this time, the cloud leads the steady state. It reaches the steady state. Unfortunately, with models, like with everything, they work like the GIGO system, which means garbage in, garbage out. So if you put the old rate for the radiative recombination, and you put the branching ratio into this is the recombination of this, like one, that actually agrees quite well with the observed methanol density, which is about here, which actually has been measured in Sweden by our colleagues in Onsala. When you put in the new branching ratios, then it gets worse. And when you put in the new rate, which our colleagues in Chemnitz have measured, then the agreement is about 2 orders of magnitude off, and this is not even acceptable for astronomers. So we have to find another way. And as my colleague David Williams usually said, surface reactions are the last refuge of scoundrels, and scoundrels rule. So what you can do is from carbon monoxide with HCO, with hydrogen reactions, you can actually form methanol. Unfortunately, these two intermediate processes, they have a barrier. So you have to test it experimentally. And lo and behold, when you actually add hydrogen to carbon monoxide ice at 10 Kelvin, then you form methanol. There have been some discussions if that really happens, but the findings have now been reconciled. But if you produce methanol that way and you allow a certain desorption from the grain, you can produce the observed abundances of methanol. And then the astronomers will say, well, that's fine what you can do in the lab here. But does it really hold in the interstellar medium? Because not everything that works fine in the lab might work in the interstellar medium. So what we did, what my colleagues and we did, was actually did some methanol observations in the interstellar medium. Because here you form the methanol from formaldehyde. And some colleagues used the IRAM telescope, it was a group in Leiden, and observed some young stellar objects and looked about the correlation between methanol and formaldehyde. Not only the geologists love correlations, we also do. And luckily, the correlation between H2CO, formaldehyde and methanol is very good. It is 0.98%. And other compounds that can be formed from methanol, like dimethyl ether, also show a good correlation. So that was good, but we can do a little bit more. And one thing is that the methanol and the formaldehyde are formed from carbon monoxide. And carbon monoxide is a little bit a rum thing because it enriches at low temperatures in 13C. Because this reaction, where I react 13C plus with CO and get 13CO, chemically you have not really done very much. You have just exchanged the isotope. But due to the lower zero point energy of this species, The reaction is slightly exergic. And that means at temperatures below 30 Kelvin, the carbon monoxide mops up all the 13C. And there is nothing left for the other compounds. So other compounds are deficient in 13C. Carbon monoxide is rich in 13C. So we look at the isotope ratio of CO and methanol. And if we compare carbon monoxide with methanol and we find a similar isotope ratio, then this is a sign that we have a process connecting these two. And this is called isotope labeling a posteriori. We did that at Onsala Space Observatory. And I have to say it's embarrassing. The agreement between the isotope ratios between CO and CH2 is in most cases, in most star forming regions, we investigated embarrassingly good. This here, with here, we are erring on the wrong, on the right side because it's even lower. But here you have got optically thick lines. So this is not really reliable. So the isotope ratio agreement is good. A low isotope ratio has also been found by Bishkop et al. In the observations. There is a worse agreement with CO2, but CO2 production might slightly proceed in another way. The problem which we encountered here is the problem with dissociative recombination. As I said, it's a highly exergic process. It leads to fragmentation, but electrons are not the only carriers of negative charges in the interstellar medium. We have also got anions. And these anions can also react with cations and form neutrals. And the anions are not so easily stripped of their electrons. They have a certain detachment energy. So it's a little bit of a more mild way of neutralizing these species, for example. Experimentally, however, these mutual neutralizations are more difficult to assess. But recently, in my institute, the double storage ring was built, and you can store in this double storage ring both negative ions and positive ions. You can merge them and look at the products. And we are expecting the first results soon. That was about ions, shortly about radical reactions. You can produce the radicals through different molecules, discharge, photolysis. You can mass select them, but it is quite a bit difficult to do that because they have no charge. Reactions between the radicals themselves are a problem. Cations do not usually react with cations because they repulse each other. Radicals are neutral, they can react with each other's shelf. So you have to have other cooling methods than you employ with ions. And one of the cooling methods is adiabatic expansion. An expansion through a nozzle into the vacuum. Adiabatic, it is called because there is no heat transfer between the gas and the environment. In real gases, you have a cooling with expansion. If you shave yourself in the morning and you put the shaving foam on your hand, it feels cold because you have got an adiabatic expansion going on. And that's what is used for cooling. So particles with a certain energy are left out until an adiabatic nozzle. Transversal energy is low because the compounds or the molecules with a high transversal energy, they will not hit the nozzle. And of course, these molecules collide inside the nozzle with each other, and they have to move at the same velocity. When I queue up at the gate in Charles de Gaulle, if they are not on strike for a change and I can board the plane, then I can only move with the same velocity with the crowd. And that's what's happening here. So we have a vertical cooling because we select the transversal cooling, because we select the more molecules with low transversal energy through the nozzle, and we have collisional cooling here. So normally, you would have a certain distribution after Maxwell and Boltzmann like that. But in a supersonic beam, which emerges from an adiabatic cooling, then you have got a very sharp distribution of the energies. Translational energy can be as low as several Kelvin. Rotational energy is a little bit larger usually in the supersonic beams, 30 to 90 Kelvin. Vibrational energy is difficult to cool because you have large energy quanta. Cooling through collisions is not as efficient in vibration, so the vibrational temperature can be up to 100 Kelvin. So what you employ often is a so-called Laval nozzle, which creates a uniform supersonic flow, and you can employ different temperatures here, 7 to 220 Kelvin. You have to use a different Laval nozzle for each of these temperatures. And as the colleagues who are working with Cressy, here there are some which do. The changing of the Laval nozzles is a little bit time consuming. So with this Laval nozzle, you can create a supersonic flow. And after a certain time after the nozzle, this flow is still supersonic and harmonious, then it collides with the ambient and it forms a so-called collision disk, and then it gets sonic. But you have a certain area where you have got a supersonic flow. And that's also you can see in when a supersonic jet flies. You have here again adiabatic cooling, and you see this disk of the supersonic flow. For the cooling, the water condenses here. And one apparatus where this is used, where I have heard that a couple of you are working with, is the Cressy, French acronym for Cinétique de Réaction en Écoulement Supersonique Uniforme. You can have, as I said, different temperatures. You can even go down to 7 Kelvin. You have got a supersonic uniform beam. You have got the reaction vessel, which has no walls, so you have also no reactions on walls. You have a rapid cooling without any condensation. The disadvantage is mostly with the large apparatus, you need very strong pumps and loads of gases. There are smaller Cressy apparatus around. I think there is one in Bordeaux, if I'm not mistaken. And as I said, you need a different nozzle for each temperature. That's how it looks like. So you actually add in a gas, which is your precursor gas for producing the reactive species. You add also the reactive gas. With a laser, you create the reactive substance, and then you let expand this through the Laval nozzle, and with laser-induced fluorescence excited by another laser, you follow the decay of the reactant here. So you can move this species, and with this photomultiplier at different distances from the Laval nozzle, you can follow the decay of the reactant. It is technically easier to move this here than to move the photomultiplier and the optics. So as I said, these pumps are quite large. They usually have 16,000 liters per second. And usually the people working with Cressy, they are keen on having these pumps in other rooms and not in the main room. So this is an apparatus. I think this is actually the first RAN apparatus I worked with. So here you have got the reaction chamber. Here I've got the OPO lasers going in. And here I've got the outlet to the vacuum to the pumps. You follow some reactions leading to larger species, and you see that these reactions are parallels because they slightly decrease with increasing temperature. You can also form more complex species, cyanopolyanes, for example, with reactions of hydrocarbons and CN. These reactions are very fast at low temperatures and work very well, so you can form quite complex species, like you can see here again. Very nice parallel behavior. So in a dense cloud, this reaction works better than at room temperatures. From HCN, for example, you can form nitriles, both by radical reaction but also for ion reactions. There are some problems, of course, when you react HCN with CH3+, then you form another isomer, CH3NCH+, and this can, in planetary atmospheres, rearrange to the right one and you can get the protonated nitrile. Why are nitriles important? Because from undergraduate chemistry, you will know the Strecker synthesis, that you can, from nitriles with ammoniac, form amino acids. So you go out from an aldehyde with HCN, you produce a nitrile, and then you actually convert this nitrile into a carbonic acid. And the most simple amino acid, the so-called glycine, has actually been tentatively detected in the interstellar medium in 2003. This detection was immediately challenged because people did not really find some lines, which they should be. Now it is more likely that it's actually there because some people claim now they have found the lines which are missing now. Anyway, we have meteorites, which can contain up to 7 amino acids and also glycine. So there is, it's not unlikely that glycine can be formed in the interstellar medium or its star-forming region. How can amino acids be found? Well, I can say simply, we have the Urey-Miller experiment. So what? You have a discharge in methanol, water, and ammonia, and you form amino acids. So that's what you do. You have got a water vapor here mixed with ammonia, methane, and H2. You do discharge and you can not only form amino acids, you can also form nuclear bases. The problem is, amino acids, as the chemists of you know and the biologists, come in two forms, which are like mirror imaging. We call this chirality because like our two hands, which we can really not really put on top of each other because they are like mirror images. We call it chirality, from the Greek word of hand, which means chir. And only this form, this L form, can be used by life. This is completely useless. And of course, when you do this, you get a one-by-one mixture of these two, which is not the situation you want. Also, when you have small traces of oxygen, it is hampered. And it is, of course, a matter of debate how much oxygen the early Earth's atmosphere contained. But it can also be delivered from space. And as I said, amino acids have been found in a Murchison meteorite. Meteorites are interestingly named always after the closest post station where they crashed in. So if we are hit by a meteorite, it will be called Letèche because there is a post office at Letèche, as you have seen. And here we have got an excess of the right form, a so-called enantiomeric excess. The problem is survival of biomolecules through the star-forming phase, where I get a lot of UV, is not very likely, but precursors of these amino acids, they might survive. Some gas phase mechanisms have been invoked, as you can see. Also grain surface processes have been invoked. So there are some complicated processes which can't lead to amino acids in space. Amino acids have been also formed by irradiation of an ice mixture of water, methanol, ammonia, carbon monoxide, and carbon dioxide. And glycine, the most simple one, has been found to be the most abundant. We don't want only amino acids, we also want sugars. And this first primitive sugars, the glycoaldehyde, has been detected in the interstellar medium and can be formed by different procedures. You can start from formaldehyde, which we have seen is formed by hydrogenation of CO. You can also form it by CH3 and O in the gas phase. And the HCO can then be protonated, activated, and then this ion can form a reactive form of this formaldehyde, the HCOH, and this can then polymerize to form some carbohydrates together with another formaldehyde molecule. You get this glycoaldehyde. And it has been detected in such scenarios B2. It has been detected in a couple of other sources so far. Nuclear bases, which we want also as astrobiologists, are difficult to form in dark clouds. They're easily destroyed by UV light in other environments. And we have not yet found any nuclear bases in any interstellar environments. One of the sources of nuclear bases could be a damn good one, D-aminomalonitrile. This can be formed by HCN, and it can actually then lead by complicated processes to some amino acids, some nuclear bases. But such complicated processes are fairly unlikely in the interstellar medium. And the same applies for the analog processes for producing pyrimidine bases. So far, to produce nuclear bases, we have not really yet got in the interstellar medium. It's, I think, time to come to some conclusions and wrap it up. I thought I have to convince you that ion-induced radical and surface reactions play a role and can build up quite complex interstellar molecules. The actual reaction pathways are often difficult to elucidate. So it's not really simple. There is no simple mechanism which works for all. Water, for example, can be formed in the gas phase. Methanol, probably not. And water and methanol are still somewhat fairly similar, similar compounds and only differ by a CH2 group. And you need really experimental investigations together with modeling, together with observations to really get a grip on the formation pathways of the simplest interstellar molecules. Now, before I conclude, I have to do some commercials because unfortunately Muriel does not pay me very much to come here. So I have to do some advertising. And what I would like to advertise is a summer school on volcanism, plate tectonics, hydrothermal vents, and life. And this will take place in the beautiful city of Angra do Heroísmo and the Azores from the 21st of August to the 1st September 2016. Lectures are held by leading scientists, one very leading scientist lecturing in the Azores we have here, Tilman Spohn. And we will have not only lectures in the lecture hall and have to walk in torrential rain, although it can rain quite heavily on the Azores. We can also do some excursions to volcanic craters, hot springs, lava caves. And we can only not to do tourist walks in these areas. You will also have the possibility to do some sampling and characterize the growth of microbes in these lava caves and in hot springs. Of course, we have the usual poster sessions and participant-led discussions. We have got a website here, which is under the Nordic Astrobiology Network, www.nordicastrobiology.net, a source 2016. Deadline for application is the 15 March 2016. And we have actually bursaries which cover accommodation in student accommodation, meals, and travel. Also, we have got a fairly reasonably priced hotel for people who want hotel accommodation. Another summer school we are organizing is called Biosignatures and the Search for Life on Mars, which is happening in Iceland. And we will visit a lot of different places, like Mars analog landscapes, but also eruption sites. This was the eruption in 2015, which created the Hohlerhoen lava field, Badabunga eruption. We will also cross the inland of Iceland, visit the Kerlingarfjöll area, which is very famous for its hot springs. And also here, you can characterize microbes colonizing extreme areas. So the deadline for the application is here on the 31st of March 2016. And you can find it also on the website of the Nordic Network of Astrobiology. That's actually what I wanted to say. And I will open now for questions. Thank you very much.